that's not good.
I don't know if they're supposed to move or.
Hello. No,
it's working.
from your garden? They're beautiful. Need help with them?
Thank you.
Good morning from Plymouth Congregational Church. We are United Church of Christ, and we come to you from Plymouth, New Hampshire, if you're watching on Facebook. My name is Reverend Sarah M. Holland, and I'm so happy to be here with y'all this morning, whether you're tuning in online or you're here physically present. So you might also want to know, if you're here right now, is it possible to watch the service on TV? And it is. It's possible. 1302 is our local channel on Pimmy Baker Access TV. So if you have someone who you know that lives off-grid but they have television, please let them know. Today we are considering God-inspired joy, so we're happy that you're here with us to celebrate in this way. We are also praying for our entire denomination as our national but also international General Synod has begun. It's virtual this year because of the pandemic, so we want to make sure that we're praying for all the people who are involved in that, whether they're national staff people or they're state staff people or any other types of folks who are joining. You can also learn more about that if you're interested in going to one of the worships. The opening worship is tonight, and the website is generalsynod.org. So there's about, if you're watching on Facebook and you're just curious about how many folks are here, there's about 10 to 15 people here, so we're so happy. They say that when it's like more two or more gather, there's worship, so that's what we have today. We're also especially grateful to all of the staff people who are present. Thank you so much, Ashley and David, and Eileen's been helping with preparations. And our ushers, we're so grateful to them. And also John Anderson is serving as liturgist, so we really appreciate y'all being here. This is our first Sunday being back in our physical space since the pandemic began, during which we're welcoming people who are vaccinated to not wear their mask if they want. If you are unvaccinated, we do ask that you wear a mask. We're not asking people to give us any record of vaccination. We're trusting that folks will use the honor system and just be honest and forthright in whether or not they wear a mask. You might, if you're like me, not be comfortable singing yet unmasked, so you're welcome to put a mask on when you feel like you need to. The signs are still up all around the church. We just haven't taken them down yet. But if you're vaccinated, make yourself comfortable. If you have a sniffle, of course, wear your mask. So just be respectful of people. We are still doing our sort of physical distancing and respecting each other in that way. So if you're going to hug someone or approach someone for a handshake, just affirm with that person in a, you know, verbal sort of way that they're okay with that if you approach someone for a hug or anything like that. And then if you interact with children in any way, just be aware of their space. They can't get vaccinated, so be aware of that. And let's see, any other mask stuff? There's a greet and go outside right in front of the church after worship. So if you want to get a seltzer or anything like that, some crackers, will be out there and say hi to people, reconnect with friends who you haven't seen in a while. Our racial justice group is meeting this Tuesday night at 7 p.m. We do know that some people aren't able to come in the summer because they're traveling and they're busy with friends and family, but if you're around, if you're in the Zoom space and you want to attend that, then we have that going on. Even if you haven't been involved in it, just let me know and I'll send you the link. And then we do, if any children or youth come in, I just ask that the ushers will let folks know that there's spaces for people to wiggle around outside of the sanctuary if they need to. They're also welcome to be here. We like when kids are around. So nice to see you, Lorelai. And then Sam Lovett's ordination is on July 25th at 2 p.m. right here. We are asking that people RSVP. I believe the RSVP can go directly to Sam, and we'll just make sure that we don't have more than, I think the number is like 125. We don't anticipate that many people will be here, but we do want to make sure we give people enough space to spread out for that service. So if you're planning to attend, please let us know, and we'll make sure there's space for you. And we will have a small reception outside again after that. So July 25th at 2 p.m., and it will be broadcast on Facebook as well. I think that's all of the announcements. Summertime is a little bit slower. We're preparing for the fall. But, you know, we're still here together, and we're happy to be here together. So thanks for being present, and thanks for tuning in on Facebook. If there happen to be issues on Facebook, we do ask that you let us know. If you let us know, we want to make sure you remember that anyone can see your comments. So if you're really frustrated and you feel angry, just don't channel that into your comment. Just say, sound is off, visual, can't see, some sort of comment, so we'll know which part of the streaming we need to fix. So do let us know. So welcome. In the United Church of Christ, we say welcome to people no matter where they are on life's journey. If you have a huge biological family, or if you have a small family and you mostly hang out with your chosen family, welcome to you. If you are single or you're partnered, welcome to you. If you are a believer, a questioner, or a questioning believer, welcome to you. We are an open and affirming church. We welcome LGBTQ+ people into the life and ministry of our church. We are a still speaking church. We encourage people never to place a period where God places a comma. And we are a just peace church. We do our best to live in the ways of justice and the ways of peace. So welcome. As we center ourselves for worship, we invite you to know that no matter where you are physically, God is with you, and God is present here in this space. Let's prepare our hearts for worship.
Please join me in the call to worship. In some ways, the world feels desolate. May we hope to find God's joy and truth in this hour. Let us hear God speak this hour. We turn our hearts to you, God. Speak peace to us. Walking towards a sunrise or a sunset, we understand your love is present with us, though we might feel alone. Glory may dwell in our land and in our hearts. With God's peace, righteousness will be actualized in a divine space. From even the land which is drought, faithfulness will spring up with God's love. Joy will abound in the most unexpected places. From the sky and from below, your love envelopes us. Let us know with our collective voices, minds, and hearts, love will be made real this very hour. Please join in singing hymn number 68, God is Truly With Us.
We're going to do the passing of the peace first before our first hymn. So what we want to invite you to do is to grab your phone. I know that's odd. You're going to take out your phone, whether you're on Facebook or you're at home. Excuse me, whether you're at home on Facebook or you are here in worship. Or if you don't want to use your phone, you can also use a piece of paper and a pencil. So we want you this week to say to someone in your notes, you have given me joy, and I pray you find joy today. You have given me joy, and I pray you find joy today. So if you're on Facebook, you're going to have to decide who you're going to send that to, right? You're going to have to look through your little friend list. You might see other people who are active. Pick a name. Or if you have a physical note, you're going to have to think of where you're going to take this note, right? So you might decide a neighbor, you might decide a car that you pass in a parking lot, you're gonna stick it under the windshield wiper. Your note's going to say, you have given me joy, and I pray that you find joy today. You have given me joy, and I pray that you find joy today. Peace be with you. So again, our first hymn is number 68, and it is correct in the bulletin. It's just that the number is listed incorrectly. So number 68, if you're in worship and you want to, you can rise as you're able and led.
Please be seated. Thank you. Please join me in the unison gathering prayer. Blessed are you, gracious God, holy maker of earth and heaven. We give you thanks through Christ, who is present with us, whose rising from the dead gives us hope of resurrection and the promise of life eternal in your light. Unite us in joy with all those who have loved in that realm where every tear is wiped away. While we come with gratitude, we come knowing our faults, insecurities, and the places which most need healing. Let us know that during this time, we are held by your love and by our kindred in Christ. Amen. It is hard for us to imagine the ways that God might be crafting in our minds, bodies, and hearts to better the kingdom. We confess that we struggle to see and hear our path towards God's love and joy. We hope to recenter around our path with God's love today. Giver of all gifts, let us reimagine the way you have set before us, and let us believe our power, which is found in you. Let us recall once again, there is nothing, nothing here, nothing anywhere else that will separate us from the love of God in Jesus. It is for this promise and spirit that we sing.
Shy. So, do you want to come hang out over here or you want to hang out over there? It's up to you. Either way is totally cool. I'll put my mask on just in case. I'll grab a spot too in case you want a spot. We're getting ready for the fall, you guys. We've got to be ready when these kids come back and we're going to be singing this song to them and I think they're going to like it. If they don't like it, then we'll just have to pick a different song. Y'all can't hear me, huh? Okay, is that better? Should it be turned up or is it good? It's good? Okay. Oh, that's nice of you, Ashley. So, you know, today is special for all of us here because we're going to shift back to doing our prayers the way we used to do. And it's hard to believe how long it's been, isn't it, Lorelai? I wasn't here when y'all went home, but Lorelai, you were probably at least a hedge smaller. So we've gone a long time without being able to say prayers aloud for each other. So I want us to take a minute right now just to hold that joy, because Lorelai, I bet when you are really, really happy about something, like Lorelai, you'll have a pet, don't you? And you like hanging out with a dog? It's a doggy, right? I bet sometimes, oh yeah, what is the dog's name? Leah is a good name. When the dog does something really, really cute, or when my cat does something really, really cute, what do you think I like to do? Anybody can answer. It doesn't need to be large. It's a message for all ages. What do you want to do? Yeah, so I think I hear you saying that you want to tell somebody, right? If I know you guys have chickens, don't you? If those chickens do something really silly, you want to tell someone. Or if you're, yeah, so sometimes if you're having a hard time, like if I hurt my leg really badly, this is more true for some of us than others of us, if I hurt my leg really, really badly, I want to tell somebody that's close to me because I'm that kind of person. Now, some of us here, maybe we don't like as much to let people know. But even if we're one of the people who is less likely to let folks know, it makes a really big difference and it can make us feel better. So, you know, if we have a chicken that's being really cute, or if we have an injury or we're sick and we want to tell somebody, it's really important for us to let folks know. And so today we get a chance to be really, really grateful that we're able to do that. So, you know, I just wanted to sort of take a moment for us to celebrate that. Let's see, in the past year and a half, we've used Zoom meetings, we've used Facebook, we've put emails out, we've had phone conversations. And it's not that that stuff is bad. It's just that it does matter when we're in this space together and we're able to say it in a sanctuary, a place that we know God to be made real in the space that we're in. So we're really grateful for that. And Lorelai, I hope maybe that one day that you're brave enough to share something with a church family. Maybe with this church family. We'll see. It'd probably be easier when people get back here, when kids are back. Let's see here. So the last thing I wanted to say is, Lorelai, do you have anything you think we should pray about? What's that puppy's name?
Leah.
That one's also named Leah. It's like Leah Jr. I love it. Well, we're going to pray a little bit about how Leah gives us joy, okay? And I'm also going to pray for Fritz and Lucille because those are my pets. So I invite everyone to pray with us. God, we are so grateful that we can speak out, that we can wiggle around, and that we can all be church together. We're so grateful for our pets. We're grateful that we can giggle when our dogs make us laugh, and when our dog juniors make us laugh, and when they give us comfort, when we can hold them close. God, whether they're chickens or kitties, we're so grateful for these things. And we're happy to be able to say these things aloud, and we're happy to be able to be together. So God, as we go this week, let us have that deep sense of gratitude to be church and to say things to each other. And God, as we go on this day, let us walk on your way. Amen. So we're going to sing our little song again. Lorelai, can I show you something I brought in here for you? Oops. I want to show you something. Your mom's going to play a song for us that you might love.
Thank you.
Scripture readings this morning from the Hebrew Bible or the Old Testament. The first is the 85th Psalm, verses 8 to 13. There is none like you among the gods, O Lord, nor are there any works like yours. All the nations you have made shall come and bow down before you, O Lord, and shall glorify your name. For you are great and do wondrous things. You are alone, God. Teach me your way, O Lord, that I may walk in your truth. Give me an undivided heart to revere your name. I give thanks to you, O Lord, my God, with my whole heart, and I will glorify your name forever. For great is your steadfast love towards me. You have delivered my soul from the depths of the Sheol. O God, the insolent rise up against me. A band of ruffians seeks my life, and they do not set you before them. But you, O Lord, are a God merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness. Turn to me and be gracious to me. Give me your strength to your servant. Save the child of your serving girl. Show me a sign of the favor so that those who hate me may see it and be put to shame, because you, Lord, have helped me and comforted me. The second reading is from Amos, 7th chapter, verses 7 to 15. This is what he showed me. The Lord was standing beside a wall built with a plumb line, in his hand. And the Lord said to me, Amos, what do you see? And I said, a plumb line. Then the Lord said, see, I am setting a plumb line in the midst of my people Israel. I will never again pass them by. The high places of Isaac shall be made desolate, and the sanctuaries of Israel shall be laid waste. And I will rise again the house of Jeroboam with the sword. Then Amaziah the priest of Bethel sent to King Jeroboam of Israel, saying, Amos has conspired against you in the very center of the house of Israel. The land is not able to bear all his words, for thus Amos has said, Jeroboam shall die by the sword, and Israel must go into exile away from his land. And Amaziah said to Amos, O seer, go, flee away to the land of Judea, earn your bread there and prophesy there, but never again prophesy in Bethel, for it is the king's sanctuary. It is a temple of the kingdom. Then Amos answered Amaziah, I am no prophet, nor a prophet's son, but I am a herdsman and a dresser of sycamore trees. And the Lord took me from following the flock. And the Lord said to me, go, prophesy to my people Israel. Merciful God, let us know that even in a desolate place, we may find your joy. Let us find ourselves in your love as we reflect, for you are our rock and redeemer. We pray that your spirit moves between words and hearing. Amen.
Sometimes the image that's on the front of the bulletin can be hard to discern what the connection is between the message and, or the service, the sort of theme of the service and the image. So I wanted to make mention of that. That image is meant to show us that even those desolate places, and if you're only listening on Facebook and you don't have the bulletin, it's a image of two folks, a younger and an older person, enshrouded in a sort of valley that's dark, and they're walking towards either a sunrise or a sunset. And you can kind of see by the silhouette of the two people that there's an amount of joy, and I like to imagine that it's because they're together, right? Righteousness will go before God. A path will be made. This is a path that we can take. This is a path that we can take. As some of you already know, I really, really love Legos. I love the way that our brains are invited to operate when we create Legos. Whether we're following the directions that we're given in a little Lego kit or we're just creating. So if you're in the pews, there are a couple of containers of Legos sitting out. They're in little Tupperware sort of containers if you get bored during the message. Not that I'm anticipating that will happen, but they're there for you. Sometimes when we're using our hands, we listen a little bit better. Once in a while, I like to imagine that God is a great commander of Legos. See, we're the Legos, right? God's piecing us together. Each Lego could be used in a variety of ways. Creative setting, perhaps a pastor or a counselor who has to figure out on the spot, how am I going to respond to this situation? Or perhaps in an orderly setting where you know exactly what to do depending on what's in front of you. Perhaps a tech person writing code. Each Lego might fit on a particular path. The difference, of course, between us humans and Legos is, well, they're little pieces of plastic. Well, that's one difference. It's indeed a flawed metaphor, but it has some use. God is, after all, shaping and aligning us, even when we don't realize it. If you are in worship, I invite you, fiddle with those Legos if you want. Tinker. Imagine the ways that God might shape. You could also doodle if you have a pen. Let me hear what God the Lord will speak, for God will speak peace to his people. Theologian Tom R. Jr. looks at the psalm for this morning from the perspective that's pastoral. This theologian discusses a common struggle for people of faith, whether in the ancient Near East from the time of the Israelites or in today's contemporary world. Tom R. Jr. notes that sometimes all a person has is a promise from God. Sure enough, many of the Israelites must have felt this way. They faced famine, all kinds of problems. All they had was a promise from God. In the Hebrew Bible or the Old Testament, Amos is categorized as a minor prophet, the prophet we've heard from. One of the earliest, though prophets were definitely around before his time. Some were believed and some were not believed. Evidence within this text suggests that Amos was active as a prophet for a very short period of time, which to me maybe means that he caused a lot of trouble. Biblical scholars J. Andrew Dearman and Jean M. Tucker note that there may have been relative peace during the time that he was around, that he was active as a prophet. So Amos traveled from the southern kingdom, that was Judah, to prophesy to the northern kingdom, Israel. This was during the time of Jeroboam II, around 750 before the Common Era, or before Jesus was around on earth. At the time of Uzziah was in charge of the southern kingdom, and Jeroboam was in the north. Dearman and Tucker note The reigns of Jeroboam and Uzziah were relatively peaceful. There had been no major threats to the small states from the major Near East powers like Egypt and Assyria. And the peace seems to have been accompanied by prosperity, at least for a few. And according to Amos, this was at the expense of many. Prosperity for a few at the expense of many sounds a little familiar, I think. What we really see in this prophetic text is a conflict between a prophet and between a priest. The prophet Amos is judging this priest, Amaziah, and what society has created for people. Amos is accused of conspiring against the state because of these harsh judgments that he has, and Amaziah challenges the way that Amos uses his voice and his authority. I imagine that Amos may have been thinking as he prophesied, righteousness will go before God, a path will be made. See, because Amos said, I'm not a prophet. Many biblical scholars lean on reflections of the English word plumb line to craft an understanding of this text. But we'll be cautious of this because the biblical scholars say that the meaning of this plumb line, well, it was inserted later in translations. The Hebrew of this word is anak, and it only appears in this one place in the Hebrew Bible. The translation to the English of plumb line did not occur until the medieval era. So all we really know about the original of this Hebrew word is that it's akin to metal, possibly a word for tin, so we might think of the tin man. Ancient interpretations, those dating back to 1800 years ago from now, they do not support the notion of centering an interpretation on a plumb line. In other words, the translation that we read in this text of Amos, it's limited. Origen, the biblical scholar from the second and third centuries of the Common Era, after the death of Jesus, refers to this language in the Hebrew Bible to note that there are ways that God is making us strong like a metal, and also names God as consistent and unwavering. Origen discusses how metal will shape metal, as in an anvil or a large hammer. This type of shaping is akin to forge welding, rather than being pieced together like Legos. Origen's interpretation is that the word of God is strong like a hammer. He notes, you can say that the holy person who is an adamant wall or who is adamant in the hands of the Lord is not affected by the hammer or the anvil. But the more one is struck, the brighter will his virtues shine. So it seems a little violent, right? Struck. It's from 1800 years ago. It's an old piece of text. But there are a number of ways to make meaning. So Legos, forge welding, what are the ways that God might be shaping you? Perhaps you feel like the Israelites, like all you have is a promise from God, but nothing more. Even you might feel like that's taking it too far. Like you can't even see that promise. We all come in a different way before God. Even when the people of the ancient Near East felt like they just had a promise, they were actually being shaped like a hot piece of metal being crafted with an anvil. The psalmist who cries out is listening for that more beyond the promise. Righteousness will go before God and a path will be made. This is a path we can take. It is. So there's actually more than one piece of good news for us today. It's not only that we are being shaped, even when we don't realize it, we also have a deeper promise in that covenant that we make with the divine, with God. When we make a covenant with God, we make a covenant with other people, because that's part of the law. As we say yes to God, we say yes to other people, yes to other situations. Promises for us today, right? We get a mortgage, we get married, we sign papers for accounts that we open, we sign receipts saying we'll pay, we make verbal promises. And sometimes we let people down, and sometimes other people let us down. The promise that God offers us is steadfast, is unchanging. And yet it invites us to deep transformation. And that is where the two people in the image are walking towards. A deeper joy, knowing that in that sunrise, that sunset, when times feel desolate and we only have that promise, God is surrounding us, shaping us, aligning us. This means that God's love is inside of us, and if we can feel this presence, we might be ready to share it with the world. Maybe you're stuck on the moment when I said, perhaps you don't even feel like you have a promise. You know that promise of God's love? If that is you, it's okay. It's okay. Because you do not have to carry that alone. You can turn to someone in prayer. You can turn to someone in conversation. You can say, I just don't know. I really don't. Everyone has been there. A trusted mentor, a friend, a family member. We have to share these deep things in our hearts. When these hard truths present ourselves, there are people in our lives who want to hear from us. I promise you that. We have to open ourselves when we're able to be the people to receive those hard truths. This is a path we can take. There are these stages of being shaped. First, we have to realize there's shaping to do. It's like a diagnostic moment. We realize that we've fallen out of touch with the spiritual path. We've stopped calling friends to check on them. Our life feels mundane. We struggle to see beauty and simplicity. There are moments beyond that when we know that there's some shaping that needs to be done, but we really just can't commit to letting go. We're holding on to control. Those next stages, we become aware that there is some shaping happening, but we're not sure how willing we are. Perhaps this is when we're most successfully challenging ourselves or the people that we love, having hard conversations with folks, being really, really honest. None of us are in the same spot. We're each on a different place. For you, a path is carved. It's before us. And it is more a question of whether or not we'll take it, whether or not we'll realize it. Do we dare allow God to honor the promise that has been written on our hearts? Do we dare let ourselves become aware of how we are being shaped, welded, pieced together, and aligned? That's where God-inspired joy is. That promise God has given you, try to realize it today, and if you can, take it to someone else. For this is the covenant. And you'll see that even there, you'll find more and more. For God will speak peace to people. Please join us in hymn number 304, All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name. We invite you to rise as you're able and led. Please be seated. So we do invite you into a time of prayer. This morning we have, again, I mentioned it already, but a first time since the beginning of the pandemic moment, so it's very exciting. We want to invite people physically present to raise up joys and concerns if they wish. You don't have to, it's not mandatory. If you have a specific prayer, you're just going to simply indicate to me somehow visually. You could dance, you could raise your hand, whatever you want, and I'll come over towards you, and you'll just speak it aloud, and then I'll repeat it into this microphone that I'm wearing. That way, everyone here and everyone at home will be able to hear it. And as we move into the next sort of moment in this process, I'll say, "Oh God, hear your people." Excuse me. I'll say, "Oh God, in your grace and mercy," and then everyone will respond, "Hear your people at prayer." So I'll give an example. This week, I mentioned it before, but we're collectively offering up prayers for our national staff as well as conference staff, and General Synod has begun, so we just want to hold all of those folks in prayer, especially people who are tired of being on screens. So, oh God, in your grace and mercy, and then everyone says together, hear your people at prayer. And we're also praying for Galen this morning. I actually cannot remember his last name, but it's a relative of the Curry family. Do you know the last name? What's the last name?
Galen Dosher.
Galen Dosher.
Son of Margie and Fred.
Galen Dosher. Son of Margie and Fred
Dosher.
He has COVID right now, so I believe it's a little serious. So we want to definitely hold them in prayer. So, oh God, in your grace and mercy, hear your people at prayer. And then, does anyone have Alice? Right. In the NICU?
He's doing okay. They're coming home today.
Okay, good.
And I guess he was 4 pounds.
So a younger Alice in your family, your namesake, had a little baby, and they're headed home from the hospital today, and the baby is 4 pounds about.
Yeah, well, it was closer.
Five. But and what's his name?
His name is Sawyer.
Sawyer.
Andrew.
Sawyer Andrew.
McNamara.
Sawyer. We'll stick with Sawyer for the purpose of the prayer, but excellent. So, oh God, in your grace and mercy, hear your people at prayer. Yes, Georgine.
I would like us all to remember older people who want to stay in their home. They're having a problem that they can't really stay there, however, to find some solution for these people.
Yeah. So we're praying for folks who are wanting to stay at home, and perhaps they're not seeing a solution in front of them. And yeah, just yesterday I was thinking about folks who also are still afraid to leave their homes, which we know there are a lot of people who are in that situation. So praying for folks in those situations. Oh God, in your grace and mercy, hear your people at prayer. Beth, did you have another one from Okay. So we're praying for Sally Jensen. Sally Jensen turned 80. So if you have time, send her a note, I think, if you have time. So prayers for Sally Jensen. Oh God, in your grace and mercy, hear your people at prayer. Eileen, did you? Yes. Reverend Barry Petrucci, Reverend Barry Petrucci, oh God, in your grace and mercy, hear your people at prayer. And I guess a final one that I would add, in addition to all the folks who are listed in our bulletin, and we encourage you to look at that whether you're here or if you're at home, you can find our bulletin on our website. Just hold those folks in prayer. You could light a candle for them as you have dinner or something. The final one I was going to add is just folks who are traveling. I think some people are traveling, but they're still anxious about it, and just send them lots of energy for a fun time and also safety. So we invite you to turn to God in silence.
Creator God, you have called us to joy. You've written a promise on our hearts, and you are shaping us. You've set a path before us, and we struggle to take this path so often. We find ourselves in the wilderness, like someone who's completely alone or feels that way. God, let us be reminded that we are in the company of your great Spirit, and also that we do not have to walk this spiritual walk by ourselves. Let us remember that we have friends here in our church and in the community. If we feel like we don't, God, let us reach out. Let us be honest with people we encounter. God, this week we hear of people continuing to end up in horrible COVID situations, and we are so saddened and tired. God, we pray that this pandemic will one day end. We pray for all of these families, for communities that are most affected, and for all the first responders, doctors, nurses, all medical personnel, especially those who are really overwhelmed and really tired. God, we pray that each person will do what they can to support the greater good, and we are so thankful for people who are administering vaccines. God, while we are grateful that we've received some much-needed rain in New Hampshire, in a way it reminds us of our climate crisis. So God, let us continue to move to collective action. Let us protect the generations that will follow us. Be with each of us as we hold individual and collective concerns, praying for the people of Afghanistan, for the people of Charlottesville, Virginia, those dealing with extreme heat in the West, the people of Haiti, and LGBTQ people in Hungary. God, for those of us who are able to travel, give us caution and respect for the spaces that we visit. For those of us who stay put in the summer months, grant that we'll find adventure right in our homes and our backyards. Be with those of us who are homeless, those of us who are having trouble paying our rent or our mortgages. Let us know that we are being shaped by you, God, that you hold us, and that we are not alone. We offer up prayers for those in our community celebrating birthdays or anniversaries. God, for people struggling with mental health and those supporting them, we lift up all individuals and families touched by addiction, and we stand in solidarity with people who are lonely or isolated. God, we pray for an end to racist policies, and we pray for all public servants. God, for those of us who are anxious about returning to some sense of normalcy, please be with us. We pray for the leaders in this church and in this world. We're especially praying for Sam Lovett as he prepares for his ordination. And we're especially thinking of national and conference staff during this General Synod. God, let us know that you are indeed piecing us together. You're welding us, shaping us. So grant us hope. We recall your words as you said, be watchful and strengthen the things that remain. Holy One, let us know that we are hidden by your great shadow, and give us charge on this day. So hear your people as we say the words that Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. As God is shaping and aligning us, we recall that we are shaping and becoming the church day by day. The work of the church is here in Plymouth, and it's out in the world, in Zimbabwe. It's been in Greece, as I know, Texas. We invite you to join in this effort. As you consider joining us, recall that divine riches have little to do with the amount of money you give, but that you are invited into the spirit of giving. If you can't give financially, at least think of a way that you can give outwardly to another person, perhaps cooking a meal. There's so many ways to show God's love. If you are able to give, you can do so online, uccplymouth.org/give, to learn more about ways to give. If you send a check, you're going to want to make sure you send it to our post office box 86. And if you're here in worship, there are baskets that you can drop checks or cash in if you're doing it that way. However you give, know that you do become a part of this church, whether you're a member or not, one that's learning and growing with the community that's surrounding it. So please give as you're able and led, and know that you're a part of God's kingdom.
Join me in the offertory prayer. Gracious God, we often feel nourished in times of greatest need. You free our hearts and light the path we walk. We give thanks for the abundance of your mercy every moment and for every opportunity for new life. Receive our humble gifts as symbols of commitment to your purposes, that we all have, all we are, and all that you call us to become may reveal your longing presence in the world and the ability of people to truly love one another. Amen. Please join in hymn 537 in the Black Hymnal, Christian Rise and Act Your Creed.
As you go this week, dare to acknowledge the ways that you are being shaped, that you are being aligned, whether you go to the chiropractor or not. Know that God's promise is written on your hearts. So go, tend the sick, share a meal, even if from afar or over the phone. If people ask you where you come from, say to them that you are part of God's family, that you have seen love in Christ. So go now in peace.